allows me to find you the old friends of Ukraine and the other countries, and I am very happy to be here. And I must say, and I must stress also that Professor Payet has already talked about almost everything about the secondary osteoporosis. So I just will say something that we had already talked. So, osteoporosis is classified as primary type 1 or postmenopausal, type 2 senile or aging related or hydropathy. And there are also the secondary osteoporosis, which is associated to conditions caused by chronic disease or drugs that interfere with maximum bone mass peak or that contribute significantly to accelerate the bone loss. Treatment in this condition may be much more complex than in primary osteoporosis, and the prognosis depends on the underlying diseases or medications. Secondary osteoporosis is much more prevalent in men than in women. More than 50% of cases of men you can identify a cause for one or more causes for secondary osteoporosis. And in postmenopausal women, usually up to 30% of the cases you can identify also an etiology for secondary osteoporosis. So the main causes of secondary osteoporosis are endocrine, nutritional, iatrogenic, other diseases, and also sedentary people. Regarding the endocrine causes, we have the Cushing syndrome, hypogonadism, hyperthyroidism, vitamin D deficiency, hyperparathyroidism, hyperprolactinemia, type 1 and type 2 diabetes, nourishing nervosa, and also acromegaly, as it was already stressed by Professor Payet. So, regarding the hyperthyroidism, we know that the most measurable complications are the heart failure and also the osteoporosis, which both are increasing with the mortality. In hyperthyroidism, there is a corticotropical osteopathy. 10 to 20% of that is the development of bone loss, more in the cortical bone. And we have also the direct effect of thyroid hormones on the bone, with increasing the osteoplastic activity and also bone resorption. Here we have the results of the trabecular bone score in a population, in a Portuguese premenopausal woman that we have performed some years ago, and which has a hypothyroidism. And as you can see, the BMD at lumbar spine was not different from in a woman with hyperthyroidism as compared to a control group. But when we have assessed the TBS, the bone quality was lower in hyperthyroidism woman as compared to the control group. And as also you can see, the lean mass assessed by DEXA was also reduced in hyperthyroidism woman as compared to the control group. And in this hyperthyroidism woman, there was also an increase of vertebral fracture as assessed by BFI or vertebral fracture assessment. So there is already an association between the low lean mass in this woman and the vertebral fractures also in this woman. Maybe there is a sarcopenic developing in this woman. Regarding the man with older than 50 years, you can see that in this man with hyperthyroidism, they have also an increased risk of all the prophets as compared to those who were not hypersaladism. In hypersaladism, the PTH has the several actions. It increases upon the reception, and it increases also the possible differentiation, and also it has also direct effects on also acid action with its anabolic activity. So in this disease, there is a hypercalcemia and also a hypercalciuria. There is a cortical bone loss, which can be also assessed at the distal radius, and there is also a fractures risk. And sometimes there is association with hyperestrogenism. The general measures and therapies are here specified to avoid drugs that increase calcemia, hydration and physical activity. Bisphosphonates, calcineamides, so we use usual mucinical set, and also surgery performed by an experienced surgeon. So, regarding the testicular dysfunction, so it is a disease that comes from the lesion of the hypothalamic pituitary testicular axis, and which can give an hypogonadism, which is associated with low testosterone and sperm production. And this is the second most prevalent etiology of secondary osteoporosis. It happens in about 30% of the cases in adults. And there is in men an estradiol and testosterone deficiency. As it's a topology where the primary hypogonadism associated with gonadal dysfunction, such as Turner or Klinefelter syndrome, and also the secondary hypogonadism associated with several times with the hyperpituitarism or surgical chemical castration, such as the use of antiandrogens and the aromatase inhibitors. So, in hypogonadism, there is a testosterone deficiency, and maybe also to an estrogen deficiency, because there is no enough substrate to estrogens, and both they can modify the bone remodulation, leading to bone mass loss. This testosterone deficiency, it may also act as indirect death effects, leading to a secondary hyperparathyroidism of the hormone reception, and also to bone loss, to a bone mass loss. So in studies that we have performed, we have in the yellow part, the hyperparathyroidism and also the column control man. And as you can see, almost 70% of the men with the hypogonadism had for low volume BMD or osteoporosis. The control arm. And we have, when we have performed the TBS in these men, we have seen that the BMD was also diminished in the hypogonadism group as compared to the control group, but also the TBS has revealed bad quality in this bad bone quality in this man. So when we use also the 3D shaper in this man, we have observed that the femoral neck cross-sectional moment of inertia, CSMI, was the best parameter to discriminate against of hypogonadism. And we also conclude that CT analysis highlighted an intense negative effect on a hypogonadism of the cortical thickness and CSMI. So these two tools that we can use after getting the text scans are maybe very useful to in our daily clinic. And the secondary osteoporosis, you know, and diabetes mellitus, you know, there is an increased risk of hyperfracture, which is 12 higher in type 1 diabetes and 1.7 in type 2 diabetes. And we also know the type 1 diabetes has low BMD and a low peak bone mass peak, which are probably associated with imbalanced metabolic control in adolescents. And the type 2 diabetes is associated most of the cases with a higher BMD, but with a low TBS, so with a better bone quality. And we also know that some drugs may also influence the quality of the bone. The glitazones have an increased differentiation in the marrow cell, in the marrow cells, in the type of cities, and also a lower osteoblast differentiation, and is associated with higher risk of pulse fractures in women. Of course, the hypoglycemia associated with insulin is also a problem, and also it can also lead to the fractures. In hypercortisolism, of course, that the chronic corticosteroid therapy is the most frequent etiology of this dysfunction, and after it we have the Cushing syndrome associated with the pituitary diseases. So in a hypercortisolism we have bone formation, decreased bone formation in osteoblasts because there is an increased apoptosis, there is a decreased lifetime, and also a decreased function of these cells, which leads to bone mass and decreased bone mass, and of course it increases the risk of fracture. So this gives also the origin to the low growth hormone and IGF-1 activities, also an hypogonadism by the corticosteroids, and which also lead to an increased bone resorption in the osteoblast and an increased bone mass loss, and also an increased risk of fracture. At the bowel level, there's also a decreased calcium absorption, which leads to an increased PTH activity and increased bone resorption and decreased bone mass and decreased risk of fracture. And at associated level, there's an increased apoptosis action and decreased function of these cells, which lead to a bad bone quality. And finally, there is also an action at the muscle with the paralysis of these automyofibrils, with the developing of a myopathy with muscular weakness and increased the risk of fractures. So the glucocorticoid therapy is the most prevalent etiology of secondary osteoporosis. It depends on the dose, the duration, and the route of the administrations. Usual bone loss is from 5 to 15% per year, and is more intense during the initial 3 to 12 months. There are more fractures identified in the first year, and more in the axial skeleton. There are no so many studies regarding the bone disease in these conditions. We know that the fratricides are many dorsal and lumbar spine hip hips and pelvis. I remember of a patient that had a diminished about 20 centimeters in 1 year because he had several lateral fractures. So it's during the first year of treatment for arthritis rheumatoides. So these fractures are usually spontaneous, associated with minimal energy of impact trauma, and regarding also liver insufficiency, osteoporosis is present in about 20 to all cases of chronic liver disease. The pathophysiology is that is associated with low IGF-1. These activities of cytokines, vitamin D dysfunction, and so on. Also, in chronic diseases, you can also have hypercellulism and also fractures. It's very frequent with age, the development of this condition. Regarding the secondary osteoporosis and other diseases, rheumatoid arthritis is several times associated with the development of secondary osteoporosis, as well as its treatment. Asthma and cancers, myeloma, breast and prostate cancers are also other causes of secondary osteoporosis. Regarding the nutritional causes, the low calcium intake and alcohol and caffeine abuse are also very, very frequent. And regarding the iatrogenic causes, you have the corticosteroids, silent administration, hypogonadism associated with LHRH agonists and aromatase inhibitors, proton pump inhibitors, somatostatin analogs used by cancer, and also in acromegaly, for instance. Glitazones, serotonin reuptake inhibitors, and some phenylephrine and phenobarbital. You can suspect of secondary osteoporosis in premenopausal women and men younger than 50 years old, in which there was one fracture or frequent fractures, repeat fractures in very unusual skeletal sites. The situation between the fractured site and age of the patient, for instance, hip fracture before 70 years old, with a Z-score below 2.0 standard deviation, or BMD reduction despite osteoporotic therapy. In the clinical management, we can suspect also of the secondary osteoporosis if there is hirsutism, some skin striae and plethora. You can think about Cushing syndrome, weight loss and diarrhea in hypercellulism and cellular screw, brusquerotic imperfect osteogenesis, and also kidney stones. You can also think associated with hypercalcemia or hypercalciuria in primary hyperceramism. And the diagnostic tests, of course, the routine tests are very important, as it was already discussed by Professor Payer. And for instance, alkaline phosphatase test that is very high can lead us to an osteo. Malacia diagnosis or hypercellulism diagnosis, for instance. regarding the subclinical conditions, you must have the thyroid function, above all the TSH, the gonadal function, studying the testosterone and the estradiol in men, also prolactin. PTH and vitamin D associated with calcium and phosphorus, urinary 24 hours urinary cortisol to the diagnosis as clinical Cushing or to confirm a clinical Cushing, and also some special tests for the day of the celiac disease.
Regarding the treatment, it must be said that we must increase the BMD and also increase the TVS and reduce the bone quality and reduce the risk fracture. It must be preferentially etiological. We must treat the cause and the patient. And if you do not find any cause, you must do then the empirical treatments. So, if you have the suspicion of osteoporosis because the patient has a first urethral fracture or a osteopenia or a high risk diseases, you can perform a DEXA, and if the scan is normal, you can make the prevention, the follow-up. If the T-score is very low, Z-score is below 2.0 standard deviation, must do clinical data, physical examination, the routine test. If you find an apparent examination, you can do etiologic test therapy. If it is negative, if those routine tests are negative, you should do the urinary calcium, vitamin D, testosterone, polyglobulin, biochemical markers, and so on. And if there is an apparent explanation, you can do the etiological therapy. If there is no explanation, you can do so. Then the treatment therapy required for the age of those patients. So, and I thank you for your attention.
Остання доповідь нашого першого засідання. Остеоартроз та коморбідність. Коваленко Маркевич.